bow before you now and just time of wonder, Lord. Father, we look to you for you are our God. We are your people. So Lord, I seek you in the message that I pray that is to bring glory to you. For as Jesus spoke many times, doing the will of his Father. I pray now, Lord, in this humble and solemn place that is holy because you're here, I too might do likewise, do the will of the one who sent me. Precious in the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. And once more, I bring to each and every one a greetings from the Lord Jesus, the Christ, and also a greetings from here at Salem, as again we are here under the, I guess it'd be the guidance of society to keep our distancing. But that doesn't mean that we have to keep our distancing from the Word, and it certainly doesn't mean we have to keep our distancing from Jesus the Christ. In fact, that's what the message of today deals with. But before I go to the message, before I go to the Word, I want to give my sincere thanks to each one who has lifted up prayers for this ministry. I want to give my thanks to each one who sent me a letter or a card to my family, a letter of encouragement, a letter of saying that that they're listening. And that's pretty scary. It's scary for me to know that there's many out there who's listening to the Word of God. So I pray today, it's kind of hard to say, do I say this morning, this evening, tonight? So as I'm getting here at Salem, Sissy and Chris, we don't even know where the curve is. But we're going to continue this. Someone asked, how long are you going to do it? As long as it takes. But I can't wait, as many of you, and I'm sure you can't wait to be back in this sanctuary, just to hear the Word of God and to hear the teachings of the Spirit of living God. I titled today's message, A Sense of Wonder. And I've chosen for the scripture just a short passage. Many of you are familiar with this passage. It's found in the 28th chapter of the book of Genesis. And it deals with the dream of Jacob. Listen for me, and if you have your Bible, it's Genesis 28, starting with verse 10. You'd like to follow along. But sometimes it's good just to sit back and just allow the Word of God just to minister to your heart. It's called Jacob's Dream at Bethel. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth and with its top reaching to the heavens. An angel of God was ascending and descending upon it. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land in which you are lying. The descendants, your descendants, will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west, to the east, to the north, and to the south. All people on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you, and I'll watch over you wherever you go. And I'll bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep, and he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. He was afraid, and he said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the very gates of heaven. What a precious time and what a precious teaching as we continue in our daily life. And as I look around and I try to take my daily advice to don't process everything you see or hear, because it's not too long until you lose that sense of wonder. I just love so much the very imagination of children. And I try to encourage that in my children from the very beginning. You know, when you hear them talking about imaginations, either with their, you know, their little stuffed toys, or maybe they might have a special, maybe a special pair of shoes, or even a special blanket that they chew on. So we need something to hold on to in times of these. Jacob, remember at this time, even the Bible says that God wasn't his God yet. When God, through Moses, penned this, he said, I am the God of your grandfather, Abraham. In fact, I'm even the God of your father. But he left out, I am your God. So I pray today as we go through these times of trials that he is our God. But I remember many times hearing little children. In fact, I've been asked from children, where does God live? And we get this pat answer that says God lives everywhere. And God, where's his home? Well, his home's in heaven. But that's only a half truth. You know, if I'm wanting a God, you know, that I can grab a hold to, I don't necessarily want a God that is far off. I want a God that is close. So in Jacob's life, when he was experiencing this great loneliness. And I'm sure many out through the world today, many even in this local community, are experiencing an intense loneliness as we're under this stay-at-home order that continues. And where is it going to end? The answer, I don't know. But I want to speak to you today and want to speak to you this message. It's not what I do know. And I know that as we look at the Bible, and we look at Jacob, we have a lot in common. We've been robbed financially. We've been robbed spiritually. We've been robbed emotionally. And Jacob had just robbed his brother of his own doing, with the help, of course, you know, if you back up some, with help of his mother. But he had just robbed his brother Esau, his birthright. But he couldn't enjoy it, so now he had to leave, and he had to hurry off, and he's headed to his uncle Laban. And many in the world today are hurrying wherever they go. And they're experiencing, as he experienced, a deep loneliness. It seems that all of his support system had changed or was disarrayed, but he was headed out, and he found this lonely place out in the wilderness, and he laid down. And the Bible says that he used a rock for a pillow. You know, in such time as this, when society and the world is reaching out to God, as God was present for Jacob, God can also be present for you and I. But I'm here to tell you through this message that we don't serve a God that is in a distant, faraway land. You and I don't serve a God that, you know, is not ever present. You and I serve a God that is in the lowest depths of your very heart. Maybe today we don't have peace. Maybe today we don't have that perfect condition. But I'm here to tell you that the Word of God can be found where there is no peace. Because Jesus told his disciple, I am the peace. Not of the world and not of society. You'll find that peace within me. As Jesus ministered throughout his earthly life, and he only ministered for roughly 3 to 3.5 years. And as his disciples matured and as his message began to change, when Jesus started out to, he told the general public around him, he called them, he said, come unto me, And that message today is still just alive as ever before. But that message is a broader sense. That's that message to the world. That's that message to the universe, that as Jesus is still saying, come unto me. But then we must get by that general assembly, that universal language, so to speak, when Jesus calls everyone to him. But all don't come. But then he gets his message a little bit deeper. And to those who came, he gave an invitation. Many didn't come. But the ones who did come to him, Jesus gave an invitation. Then Jesus said, to follow me. And then a few of the ones who came didn't follow. But some did. So now he's began to speak to his followers. And to those who followed him, he gave another urging, and he said, now that you came, now that you follow, and then Jesus says, I want you to abide in me. You see, the message is getting more personal each and every time that Jesus speaks to us. And then the message from a couple weeks ago, remember Jesus was in the upper room, and he was talking to his disciples, and as they accepted him as their Messiah, but now, as he says, now I want you to abide in me. And then he goes on to say just a little bit deeper, as you abide in me, I will abide in you. And there he's not talking to the universal world. He's not talking to just the ones who came. Now the invitations is to the one who knows Jesus is. Now he's saying, now we can have that relationship that I long for you to have. Now we can have that relationship as I am the vine and you're the branch. Now there's that connection, that relationship, where that energy of Jesus, that sanctification, that purity of Jesus can now flow from Jesus unto me. That's where Jacob found himself upon that night. He had lost that connection with his family, and now he was out in the desert, but Jesus still had a purpose for him. Jesus still has purpose for each and every one of us. And so much of that sometimes gets hidden in the language of society of the day. Sometimes, or many times, we feel that Jesus, or even God Almighty, is living in heaven. And the Bible says, yeah, I'm there, but I want to be in you. You see, that's that sense of wonder that so many times in life we lose when we grow old. You know, we have a flash of that heavenly understanding sometimes. That something just comes as maybe a strobe light as it fills the room. And maybe you just sense that presence of Jesus is that inner peace. And it's just there just for that blink of an eye, just for that moment. But Jesus is here to tell you, and the Word of God is saying, yeah, but I want to engulf myself. I want to have myself in you. In measures that you just can't understand. So there, as he looked down upon Jacob in his dream that night, God was seeking a closer relationship. God not only wanted to change Jacob at that moment, he wanted to change him for a lifetime. So God not only lived at the time when Jesus was on this earth, but there is a God that lives within, and you only find him through Jesus. There is a God that lives within and is so close that he can almost taste him in the saltiness of your tears. You can almost feel him and hear him in the beating of your heart. That's not a God that lives out in the wonders of the world. That is a God that lives in the sense of wonder. You might not understand it. You might not comprehend it. But the idea of God everywhere, that's nothing new. The idea that God is in everything is from the very beginning of time. But God has been pushed out. God has been pressed out for so long that we forget to understand, even as Christians, even as believers in the Word of God, even as we know and we follow God and we came to him, through Jesus, and we've came to him through his word, and we've came to him through communion, but we pressed him out for so long that now we have lost that withinness. We have lost that sense that when God is within us, that is a presence that you can fence feel, and you can almost taste the living spirit of a living God. I could just speak for hours of the times that God has came within me when I never even asked him. In moments of wedding, and I have made it a practice to give the bride and the groom a charge when they stand before me at a wedding. And you know, most of the time we see the bride and groom as they're turned and they're looking at the audience, or they're looking back at the sanctuary. And let me just share one quick story, because that clock on the wall was still ticking. So I need to get through this real fine so I can get to my next point. But what I'm saying, I had a wedding one time for my grandson, Craig Pritt, and his bride, Rachel. And it was at Huntington, West Virginia, in a little Baptist church right in downtown Huntington. And the church was pretty well full. There was probably 100, 150 people there. And I had the wedding. It was like four or five steps, a little higher than this. And when it came to the charge, I turned them around to me. And I had them looking directly at me. And I began to give them a charge. And both of them was runners. And I began to speak about how your life is like a runner. And many times in life, we just run. For no reason. And then you begin, sometimes you get the cramps in your legs, in your stomachs, in your arms, and the whole body tells you to just stop. Just stop running. It's not worth it. And at that very moment, in that little Baptist church in Huntington, West Virginia, the Spirit of the living God came and indwelled it. Everyone within the presence felt it. There wasn't a person in that sanctuary that didn't sense the presence of a living God there. And as I turned them back around, and you can see the tears in their eyes, and the tears in the eyes of the people that understood it and really grasped it. And when the wedding was over, and I remember I was in a borrowed sanctuary, and I had a borrowed mic, and I took it back to the sound person that was up in the upper balcony. Probably the greatest thank you I've ever received at a wedding was from that young lady who was running the sound system. As I handed her my mic, she said, "Thank you, Pastor, for that worship service. Didn't call it a wedding. You see, Jesus showed up within. No longer was he just in heaven, or as Job says, in the depths of the sea. He was abiding in your heart. Too many times we look for visions of angels, and God says, I'm in your heart. I'm where I belong in you. My abiding presence is within you." That's what Jacob was looking for. He had left the family. He had left the home and was in the wilderness. Many of you today, wherever you are, you might have found your wilderness. But according to the teachings of the living God, that's where you'll find the abiding presence. Oh, he's in the terror of your life. But loneliness can't drive him out. Loneliness only drives him deeper within the abiding presence of who he really is. So if he's in the terror, he's also in the pain. You know, and I'm so thankful that what I've learned over the years, that modern man has fell into the trap of believing that you can't sense the presence of God unless you can explain everything. You can't sense the presence of God unless you're at peace with your fellow man. Now that does help. Or unless you're at peace with everything around you, and we get all this silliness that You can't sense God's presence. Does all the planets line up? But there is a wonder. And to lose the sense of wonder, one grows rigid. To lose a sense of God is that abiding presence is unable to accept the grace that God wants to bestow upon each and every one of you. And I would challenge each one, don't make the mistake that Jacob was about to make. Let me read for you after he'd seen the vision. And he said, "This is the house of God. This is the very gates of heaven." And the next thing he did was start to barter with God. He said, "Oh God, if you'll just bless me, if you'll give me a house and a place to eat and a place to sleep." He said, "If God, you'll be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking and will give me food to eat, clothes to eat, and a place to sleep, so that I might return early to my father's house, then, Lord, you'll be my God. Lord, if you'll just take away this bondage, then I'll believe in you. If you just take away this trial and bring all my friends here, then I'll believe in you, Lord." And we become rigid and we lose that sense of wonder. We lose that faithfulness of Jesus as a living vine. I challenge each one today, wherever you are in your life, wherever you are in your walk with Jesus, don't lose that sense of wonder. I have in our dining room, it's an old grandfather clock. Some of my kids just literally hate it. But we bought it, and in fact, just last Sunday, I oiled it again. When we bought it, we put a little tag on it. 28 years ago, we got it for the family for Christmas. So it's been running steadily for 28 years. But when we bought it, the salesman said, "Now this clock will be faithful running for roughly 100 years. All you have to do is keep it dust-free and oil it once a year." They give me a little vat of oil, probably 1 or 2 ounces of oil. So I got the oil out and I looked at it. The last time I'd oiled it, and I thought in my mind was 3 years ago. I read the date, 2015. It's been 5 years since I oiled the clock. So I took it apart and oiled it, put it back together, and it started right up, and turned the dial around to where it chimes, and played the Westminster chimes, and it was the most ungodly thing I ever heard. It used to have that beautiful tone that just resonated through the house and resonated even through your very being, but it had got out of timing. You couldn't even understand it, and it wasn't striking right, so I had to recalibrate it. I had to put the tumblers back in order to where it would strike at the right time and the right texture, even the right touch. So after a couple hours, I got the old grandfather clock to tone again. Oh, what a pleasant reminder. Coronavirus, don't let it get you out of time. Don't let it get you out of thinking that God is just in this faraway land. No, God is abiding in your heart. God is even that pillar of stone when we lay down at night. So I challenge each and every one world around us might be chattering and just tossing to and fro. But let us learn a great value from this that we're going through now. So if we don't learn a great value, that's failure. The life that God has called us to be is sometimes difficult, but all the abiding presence of Jesus is absolutely important. So let's glorify God this week. More than that, let's glorify God. Shall we pray? Our Father in heaven, may the abiding presence that you showed to Jacob and all you showed through your son Jesus, Lord, may you live and call the ones you've called, Lord. You said follow. The ones that follow, you said abide. So, Lord, may we find the greatest peace of all in abiding in you and you in us. God bless you all.